Hey, thanks, Jordan and the team. You can tell that it must have been really cold here this morning when they came in for practice. They're all still wearing their puffer jackets and everything, but really appreciate what you guys have done this morning leading us in singing this in worship. Well, take your Bibles and open them to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. This morning I've actually got something a little bit different in store for us than what we would normally be doing. Maybe if you're visiting us today, we normally would take the Word of God and we would open to a book, and we've been expositing in our way through books of the Bible. And at the moment, we're going through the Gospel of Mark, but we've put that on hold just for today. I'll pick it up again next Sunday. Today, in some ways, it's not a sermon. I know Jordan's kind of prayed for that, and thank you, Jordan, for that. But, you know, we are going to look at the Word of God, and there'll be a number of verses we'll look at this morning. But really, I just want today to be a little bit of a pastoral reflection, you could say. Maybe it's just a little bit of a personal chin wag. You could say it's really the practical application of the verse I want you to look at, and that is in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 11. It's a verse that's very familiar to all of us, I'm sure. The principle in it is very familiar. It simply says this: encourage one another and build one another up. So I want to think about that this morning, and especially that word encourage. I mean, in the original language, we've looked at this word before. It's the word parakaleo, and it has a broad meaning. Literally, it means to come alongside. The word para is where we get the word parallel, two lines alongside each other. So it's para, which is alongside, and kaleo, to call. So the idea is to call alongside. And when you take that Greek word and you translate it into English words, there's a number of words you can use to explain what it means. For example, it means to come alongside and encourage, which is as it's translated in many of your versions. That means to build somebody up, to, in a sense, put courage into them. The word also means to admonish people. That's the idea of maybe just a little rebuke to help put them back on the straight and narrow. The word also means to exhort people. And that idea is kind of like a bold challenge, maybe even to help somebody to step up, to do something a little bit more significant. And the word parakaleo also means to comfort. And obviously that's the idea of coming alongside people who are perhaps struggling in life and putting your arm around them and comforting them and helping them, and even those who may be grieving. And so it's a multifaceted word. And so this morning, as we think about that verse and that word, I think that all of those meanings are going to be relevant for us as we talk about a few things. And if you've still got your Bible open at 1 Thessalonians 5, just go down a couple of verses to verse 14, because not only are we told to encourage one another in verse 11, but look at verse 14, and it says there that we urge you, brothers, admonish the idle, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, and be patient with them all. And so really what I want to do this morning is to flesh out verse 11 and verse 14. And I want to be that source of encouragement that I trust I can be, and to bring a challenge to us this morning where that would be necessary, but also perhaps to minister comfort if that is what we need to do this morning. And you might ask the question, well, why am I doing this? Well, simply I'm doing it because a lot of things have happened in the last week or two and in the life of many of us, and I just want to sit back and reflect on some of those things from a biblical perspective and give some counsel and some encouragement about what's going on. And you might say, well, what's happened? Well, to give you a quick overview, we've obviously talked about a few of those things this morning already, but as you already know, we have lost some dear friends and some dear family members in the last few days. They've left this planet and they've gone to glory, which we are glad for them in that sense, but they leave a hole behind. And so I want to talk a little bit this morning, just for a little bit, about death and dying and hope and what Scripture has to say about that. But also in the last week or 10 days, we've had Impact Bible Conference. And the theme this year was discipleship. And last Sunday morning, Chris Mueller stood in this pulpit and he preached a compelling message from 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 10 and 11. And so I just want to reflect on that a little bit this morning as well, and see how some of those truths can be applied to our lives. And then during this last week, I had I had a little Wellington adventure. Many of you know my brother-in-law Nigel Shaler was supposed to be coming out to Impact last week with Chris Mueller. Chris and Nigel are on the same pastoral team over in Southern California, but Nigel had a pancreas attack, and so he wasn't able to travel at all. He had to stay behind. But Nigel is the perfect administrator, if you want to say it that way. And before he came, he had already scheduled a trip for Chris Mueller to go to Wellington for a couple of days of sightseeing after the conference. And so Nigel had already pre-booked and prepaid a whole lot of things to do. And Chris Mueller hates driving. He won't drive in New Zealand, obviously. It's the other side of the road. So somebody had to take Chris to Wellington and look after him. So I volunteered to do it. So I did that for a couple of days. And you might say, well, why go to Wellington? I mean, surely there's some nicer places to look at, and I agree. But you know, Chris has had the privilege of being to New Zealand before, and he's done Hobbiton, and he's been all around the South Island, probably done a lot more than some of us have done. And I think secretly, Nigel wanted to go to Wellington because he's a fan of, remember that old TV series, The Thunderbirds? From, you probably have to be like 50 or older to remember that. But anyway, that they are redoing that as a series, and they're doing it down at the Weta Workshops in Wellington. So anyway, Nigel booked in to go and see that. But anyway, we went to Wellington. We did go to Weta Workshops. We also went to Parliament, and we went to Te Papa, and maybe I'll just reflect on some of those things later on. But first of all, just want to reflect really on death, dying, what Scripture has to say about that, and hope and eternal life. As you know, one of our elders, Graham North, has farewelled his precious wife from this planet this past week on Tuesday. She lost her battle, as it were, with cancer, but she gained her heavenly reward. And today really is the first Sunday we could say that she is able to worship Christ face to face in heaven and in glory. And so we're thankful for that. And as I mentioned also, Peter and Eddie have lost their stepmother, and she died on the same day, I believe. In fact, 7 minutes apart, I think, from Helen and their stepmom. I mentioned Faye Eves as well. She was certainly a faithful servant. She attended here for a number of years, as I said, and with her husband, Doug. Just of recent times, she's been fellowshipping with her sister and with her friends over at Good News Bible Church in Havelock. But I also heard during the week as well, a past member of OBC passed away. I think some of you old ones may know Roland Rout, I think his name was. So just be mindful of that family as well. And then not only that, during the week when I was down in Wellington, actually, I found out that a gentleman by the name of Andy Bray passed away. Andy, some of you may know him, was the director of Family Life New Zealand. And my cousin and his wife went around the country doing marriage enrichment seminars with that couple. And so that's a sad time for that ministry. Andy, you may recall a number of years ago, some of those students from the Elam High School in Auckland were drowned in that canyoning accident. Well, his daughter was one of the ones that had passed away in that accident. So anyway, all of these things have happened, and it's been a sad week. And I think it's important, though, for us to think about death and dying. Oftentimes, we don't want to talk about it. We don't want to think about it. But from a Christian perspective, we do need to think about those things. And, you know, there's no doubt that death is the enemy of believers, but it's not a victorious enemy of believers. Death does not win. It does not conquer Christians ultimately. It doesn't have the final say in our lives. I really like a description of death that was written by a Christian author. I can't remember the guy's name who wrote it, but he says this about death. He says, death is the most misunderstood part of life. It's not a great sleep, but a great awakening. It is that moment when we awake, rub our eyes, and see things at last the way God has seen them all along. And I like that, you know. That is the experience of all of those loved ones that have passed away in recent times, that they can now, as it were, see things clearly like never before. 1 Corinthians 15 is an encouraging passage for us to think about in the face of death as well. It is that passage that reminds us that death does not defeat us. It says there, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Great verses, great encouraging verses for us. And then it goes on and says, therefore, because of this victory, because of this great hope that we have in Jesus Christ, the author Paul says here, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. And so we read verses like that and we're reminded that sin has been defeated by Jesus Christ and death has been defeated by Christ. And it doesn't have to have the last say. And so therefore, for a believer, there ought to be no fear in death. I mean, we don't look forward to the way that we're going to die, but death itself should not scare us. When we think about life, when we think about death, it's also important that we remind ourselves that God is the one who ordains our days, even before we were born. Psalm 139 reminds us of that in verse 16. It says there, the psalmist says, your eyes, talking to God, your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. And when you think about that verse, we have to conclude that there are no accidents in God's economy. None. Only appointments. God is in complete control of our lives. We don't live a day longer or a day shorter than what God has planned for us. In fact, there's another great verse to consider in this discussion, and that is, when you think about it, before anybody ever walked on this planet, on planet Earth, God not only had the dates filled in your birth certificate and on your death certificate, according to Ephesians 1 verse 4, if you are a Christian, that verse tells us that God chose you to be in his spiritual family before the world was even created. So God is fully and sovereignly in control of our lives, every aspect of it, not only our physical life, but also our spiritual life. And I think that should give us incredible hope, because that ought to instill in us not only hope, but peace and assurance that everything is okay if God is in control of it. You'll be familiar with 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 and 14 as well. There, the Apostle Paul says, we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, and talking about those believers who had already passed away. He says that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. And then he goes on, he says, encourage one another with these words. And so this is a great reminder as well for us as believers that Christ is coming back. And when he comes back, believers who are alive at the time, but also those who have already previously passed away, they are going to be with Christ forever and forever. And so it's super encouraging as we think of what the future holds for a believer. The Apostle Paul also said in Philippians 1, he said, to depart and be with Christ, and he's talking about dying there, to depart and be with Christ is what? That's far better. Far better, he says. He says it's far better than staying here on this planet, and he's right, isn't he? He says it's far better. He doesn't say it's just okay. He doesn't say it's just all right. He says it's far better to be with Christ. Paul also said to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. That's why we have confidence that when our loved ones pass away, the instant they pass away, they're immediately with Christ in glory forever and forever. You know, someone, I don't know who it was, coined the phrase, this is not our home. We're just what? We're just passing through here. You know, sometimes we get too connected and too attached to this planet, don't we? But this is not our home. Our home is heaven. And so we have great hope as believers, and we can live like that. You know, when just while I was away with Chris, he was talking to his wife, and he was making some arrangements. They're going to visit their grandchildren. Their grandchildren live in Hawaii, which is really cool. He was going to go and visit them. But while he's over there, they've had the opportunity or been given the opportunity to fly to the big island of Hawaii. And you know how the lava's going everywhere over there at the moment? They've organized a flight in a helicopter to go and see it. And I said to Chris, like, aren't you worried that the volcano might just blow up while you're there and, you know, take you out? And he's like, amen, praise the Lord, I hope it does. What a great way to die, you know. And then we're talking to his wife on the phone about that, and she's got the same mindset. She couldn't care less. You know, if that's the way the Lord wants to take us, so be it. What a great way to go out. But you know what, as Christians, we can think like that. When our minds are set on things above and not on things below, you know what, we should be really aching for heaven, because that's our eternal home. You know, I was reading during the week about Steve Jobs. You know, he was the CEO of the Apple company. He died a few years ago of pancreatic cancer. He was only 56 years old. These are apparently some of the last words that he shared in his life while he was on this earth. And Steve Jobs is obviously a billionaire when he died. He said these things. He said, aside from work, I had little joy. He said, the recognition and wealth that I took so much pride in have paled into and become meaningless. This is while he's just a few days, I think, before he passed away. He said, you can employ someone to drive the car for you, to make money for you, but you cannot employ somebody to bear sickness for you. As we grow wiser, he said, we slowly realize that wearing a $300 or a $30 watch doesn't matter. Both tell the same time. It doesn't matter if you drive a $150,000 car or a $30,000 car. The road and the distance is just the same. It doesn't matter if you live in a 100-square-meter house or a 300-square-meter house. The loneliness is just the same. And he says, when you fly first class or economy, if the plane goes down, you both go down with it. And then he said this, he said, true inner happiness does not come from the material things of this world. And he would know, because he had everything he wanted. You know, sad reflections really from a man who was probably one of the wealthiest guys on the earth. He had no hope as he faced death. And such a contrast, isn't it, to those of us who are believers, as we face death, we've got all the hope in the world. A lesson also on that for us too, right? Money can't fix everything. It can fix some things, but it doesn't fix everything. It doesn't fix the ultimate things in life. And so we need to make sure we're not deceived thinking that life is all about being successful and being wealthy. Life's not all about that. It's about living for Christ, and it's about serving Him. And so it's better to die as a believer with no money and no home and no car and no material possessions than to die with $1 billion in the bank and not be a follower of Christ. Sometimes I think we need to remind ourselves of that. Because our hope, our eternal hope, is found in Christ alone. Eternal life is found in Christ alone. John 14, verse 6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. That's the only way to get to heaven, through Jesus Christ. And so even as we reflect on some of these things, you need to be asking yourself the question, you know, am I seeking Christ? Am I following Christ? Because only when we're doing that is there true hope in life. Now, I realize too that as we talk about these truths about hope and eternal life, that doesn't remove the sadness that can come. It doesn't remove the grieving that takes place. It doesn't remove the loneliness that can happen when we lose a loved one. And all those things are normal. All those emotions are okay. They're the normal things that happen. And so it's good, even as we have this little discussion, to remind ourselves that not only is God the one that we put our hope in, but God is the one who brings comfort to us when we are going through difficult times. He is the one who brings peace in our hearts. He's the one who can help us in the midst of suffering and in the midst of grief. It's 2 Corinthians chapter 1 that talks about that our God is the God of all comfort. He understands our grief. He knows the heartaches that we face. He's aware of the loneliness and the pain that accompanies death. You know, Scripture would tell us that God is the Father to the fatherless. He's a rock. He is our sure foundation. He has those everlasting arms that hold up and sustain those who are hurting. The Psalms tell us over and over again that God is our hope, that He is our joy, that He is our strength, that He is our strong tower, and He is the one that we can run to when we face troubles. Jesus said this, "Come to me, all you who are burdened and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Great promises for us to reflect on and think about and be encouraged by in the midst of difficult times. Paul reminds us also in Romans 8 that nothing, absolutely nothing, including death, he says, can separate us from the love of God. So no matter what happens in life, we will not be separated from the love of God. So whenever we face death or dying, we must run to Christ. We must run to God, for He alone is the one who can sustain us and give us the strength and the comfort and the hope that we need. So just a few thoughts to think about as we think about death and dying. But I want to take another angle now, and just the second reflection that I want us to think about this morning is really Impact Bible Conference. We've had that obviously in the last week or two, and the conference this year was about discipleship. And Chris Mueller has a definition of discipleship. He says it this way: it is intentional relationships for the purpose of spiritual growth. Do you get that? Let me say it again. It is intentional relationships for the purpose of spiritual growth. The idea is to help that we would be helping other people become more like Christ. And so he kind of spent the weekend and a few days before the conference actually started talking about discipleship and even debunking the myth that discipleship is just one-on-one getting together, having a coffee at a cafe and maybe having a book and talking through the book. He also talked about discipleship not being primarily one person maybe teaching a little group. That's not really the heart of discipleship. Now, discipleship does include those things. I mean, one-on-one can be discipleship and in a little small group. But discipleship, he says, is, and the Scripture says, is every member of the church using his or her spiritual gift to build up others in the church. That's what discipleship is. That means discipleship is to be the heartbeat of a healthy church where everybody is involved. And if you're not involved in this kind of discipleship, then you're not fulfilling the role that God has given you in the local church. And so last Sunday in this pulpit, Chris preached that message to us from 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 10 and 11. And he talked about the importance of using your gift, your spiritual gift, in the church, because that's what makes the church healthy. That's what makes the church strong. And his sermon title gave us the reminder that as we do that, that is what puts the power of Christ on display in the church when we're all serving, using the gifts that God's given us. So he essentially said this to us, he didn't say it this way, I guess I'm reflecting on it, but this is the concept. If you only show up on a Sunday morning to this part of church life, and this is the only role that you play in the life of this church, then you are contributing to making the church unhealthy. If that's all you do, just come on a Sunday morning for an hour and a half, and you're not serving in that context. You know, 1 Corinthians 12 talks about the church being a body. Every member has a part to play in the body. And remember, Chris used the illustration of the jigsaw puzzle was his illustration. Every piece of the jigsaw is unique, just as we are. But every piece is just as important, and we all need to play our part. And so he reminded us of the importance of all of us being involved. He said, you know, we were saved to serve. I think he said things like, there's no unemployment in God's kingdom. And so here comes, I guess, the exhortation that we need to think about. The question is, how am I doing in that? How am I doing in that? And maybe here's the question we need to think about. What am I doing to proactively help others in this church become more like Christ? What am I doing? What are you doing? Because God's given all of us a spiritual gift, and He's called us to use it for His glory and for the benefit of the church. So ask yourself that question, reflect on that. Are you using it? Are you using it maybe in a small group ministry? Are you using it maybe on a Sunday morning? If you've got the gift of hospitality, are you using that gift by having people into your home for meals? If you've got the gift of mercy, are you visiting people? Are you reaching out to people to do that? One area of real need, I think, in our church at the moment is like the ministry to the young mums in this church. We've got so many little babies around now, which is fantastic. But, you know, there's a lot of new mums, young mums, who need encouragement and who need help. And I want to encourage some of you older ladies, if you've got the time to do it, and I know probably you have, to go and encourage these young mums. Go to their homes. And I'm not saying go to their homes and have a two-hour Bible study. I'm saying go to their homes and minister to them by helping them with the dishes, by helping them with the vacuuming, by helping them hang out their washing, whatever it is. And as you're there, have a chat with them, talk with them, encourage them. Remember, it's intentional relationships for the purpose of spiritual growth is what we want to be able to do. And so that's a great ministry to be able to have with those young mums in the church. And maybe some of you older couples come alongside those, not just the young mums, but the young couples, and encourage them, invite them over, and talk about life. Talk about what it's like to be married for 15 years or 20 years or 25 years. Help them understand what that's all about. So there's multiple opportunities to minister in the body. You don't have to be on a roster. You don't have to be leading a ministry to use the gifts that God's given you. You know, last Sunday night, I went and visited Helen at the hospice, and Graham was there as well. And he was just asking how the weekend was going with Impact Bible Conference. And he asked especially how the service had gone here on Sunday morning. And I kind of just stopped and thought about that for a moment. And I said to Graham, and I think Helen could still hear and understand a little bit at that time, I said the sermon was about you and Helen, because it was about serving other people. And you know what? Two of the greatest servants in this church, Graham and Helen North. You know what? Chris talked about sometimes some churches, 20% of the people do 80% of the work. Well, sometimes Graham and Helen did 80% of the work by themselves. It seemed like at times, you know. Just because they were willing to serve and serve Christ and serve the body of God. They didn't complain about it. They loved it. And so they're an unbelievable team doing that. And I mean, when you really think about it, how many of us have been loved and encouraged by that couple? How many of us have been blessed and served by them? How many of us have enjoyed hospitality from Helen and Graham? Meals, hugs, smiles, words of encouragement. I think there would be most of us who've fall into that category. And you know what? Her servant heart was evident even right up to the end. As she lay in bed and her losing her physical strength, she was still thinking about others. One of the last conversations I had with her was how she just loved to be able to minister to the international people who come to this church. And just read the other day, you know, in regard to the memorial service coming up, she doesn't want any flowers. She wants any contributions that we can give to go to Stanley, who's over in Africa and Kenya. That's her heart. She's still thinking about other people right up to the very end. And so we're going to miss her, obviously, in lots and lots of ways. And maybe the question I want to ask this morning is who's going to step into the gap? Who's going to help fill the hole that she has left? You know, if every couple in the church or every person in the church served like they did, this church would be unbelievable because we'd be able to reach out and minister to so many more people. And so I want to encourage you to think about that. Who's going to fill the spot? Who's going to love the international visitors like she did? And I know Graham still will. But Graham can't cook as well as Helen cooked. And so, you know, we need others who are going to be able to step in and do that and be hospitable to those people. And you know what? God's gifted some of you to do that. And he wants you to use those gifts to be able to minister to people like that. Well, just one little last reflection to think about, and that was going off to Wellington. You know, while I was in Wellington, I said we visited a couple of places. One of those places was Parliament. Our family have been to Parliament before, and we've looked around, but this time, as I was walking around Parliament, it was maybe a little bit different. I'm a little bit older now and maybe a bit more interested in some of the things that happened in that building. And this time, as I walked into the debating chamber, as it were, I think it's officially called the House of Representatives, I sort of went in with new eyes and a new mind. You know, this is the room that you can watch on TV if you ever want to watch Parliament TV. I know probably most of us don't, but, you know, oftentimes this is where they just, unfortunately, some of those politicians act like little kids. But that room is a significant room. You know, I went in there and we stood there and I looked over there, and that's where the Prime Minister sits, and that's where the Deputy Prime Minister sits, and that's where the Leader of the Opposition sits, and that's where the Speaker sits up there. And I just got thinking, this is the room where laws have been passed that are completely opposite to what the Bible says. And I talked about that a little bit, I know, a few weeks ago, but, you know, I was thinking about, this is the room where Section 59 of the Crimes Act was amended, which removed parental right to use reasonable force to discipline their children. In other words, the anti-spanking law was introduced in that room. This is the room where the New Zealand government introduced a bill that redefined marriage as being between two people, regardless of their sex, sexual orientation, or gender identity. This is the room where the Labour Party are wanting to legalize abortion. I mean, as it stands in New Zealand, abortion is a crime, unless the mother can get the approval of two doctors. But the government want to legalize murder in that room, murder of the unborn child. And then in this room, as well as other select committee rooms around that room, there's going to be discussions hosted in the next few weeks and months about whether or not people will be allowed to end their own lives because they don't want to live anymore for whatever reason. The euthanasia bill. I mean, we live in a warped country in some ways. You know, it's ironic, isn't it? Or maybe a better word is hypocritical, or maybe a better word is stupid. We are working hard in this country, supposedly, to reduce the suicide rate, and at the same time, we're giving the green light to kill unborn babies and allowing anyone who really doesn't enjoy life for whatever reason to end their life prematurely. I mean, that just sounds hypocritical and contradictory to me. It doesn't make sense. It's not good news. It's not all doom and gloom, obviously. I mean, this country is a pretty good country to live in, but there's some things going on that we just don't agree with. But I need to think about that, and I want to respond the right way to that. And I have to remind myself, and I want to remind you about this as well, as I was thinking about this. The government is not going to fix our country. I know they want to. The government are not going to fix our country. The gospel is. Let's not forget that, okay? It's the gospel that is more important than anything else. And I understand politicians mean well. I mean, they want to fix our problems. And although all of those moral issues are important and we need to have our say on those things, they are not as important as the gospel. The gospel is far, far more important than all of those things. Those other things are important. We don't want to push them aside. But the gospel is the most important thing, and that's what should drive us. And so Scripture even tells us we need to pray for our Prime Minister and for our politicians and submit to their leadership. The Bible says, honor the king. The principle is that we honor our leaders. Remember this, the politicians are not our enemy. Even though they might make decisions that we don't always agree with and we don't always like, they're not our enemy. The Bible says they're our mission field. They need the gospel just as much as any other person who is without Christ. And so I need to remind myself of that as I went through Parliament. But let me remind you too that God is the one who controls even governments. He controls our government in according to Scripture. He always has and he always will. And we may not like the current government, but you know what? God is in control of our governments. Let me remind you about God's role in our government, and in fact, all of the governments around the world. Daniel chapter 2, verse 21 says, God removes kings and establishes kings. If I put that into 21st century terminology, it's God removes prime ministers and he establishes prime ministers. And as I said before, Romans 13:1 says, every person needs to be in subjection to those who govern us. There is no authority, Romans 13:1 says, except from God. And those which exist are established by God, whether they're believers or unbelievers. God's in control of this. And so the government of New Zealand is put there by God. It's God who determines the outcome of our elections ultimately. Proverbs 21 verse 1 says this, the king's heart is like channels of water in the hand of the Lord. He turns it wherever he wishes. God makes the kings do what the king's doing in that sense. You know, if you think about the king in the olden times, in Old Testament times, the king was a very, very powerful leader. It was the king who could make a decision by himself, and that decision was final. He was the one who was in charge. And yet, Proverbs 21 says, the king's every decision was always subject to the overarching sovereignty and control of God. And that principle applies to our prime minister and to our politicians. The prime minister is subject to the sovereign hand and guidance of God. Now, as you think about that, you're probably wanting to ask me some awkward questions about that. Questions like, does that mean that the redefining of the marriage bill and the anti-spanking bill and the abortion bill and the euthanasia bill are all part of God's sovereign plan? Well, the answer to that question is yes. Yes. Does that mean that those bills are good? No. No, it doesn't. Then you might say, well, how come God lets them take place? And the answer to that question is, I don't know. I don't always know. Maybe it's God's judgment that he talks about in Romans chapter 1 is the reason. All I know is that God is sovereign. God is powerful. He says in his word that he's controlling all of the events of government. And at the same time, he is perfect in his love. He's perfect in his wisdom. He's perfect in his power. So we don't always know why God ordains bad leaders to rule countries and to rule nations. We don't know. Maybe it's because the light of the gospel shines a lot brighter with a backdrop of darkness. We don't know. And so we do know, though, that the New Zealand government is appointed by God no matter who it is. And it's our responsibility, as I said, to pray for them, to submit to them, unless, as I said the other week, unless they violate Scripture and make us violate Scripture, then we would be under the principle of obey God instead of man. And you may even be thinking, if God is in control, does that mean that we don't have to pray or we don't have to vote? Well, the answer to that, no, of course not. God's reign and rule includes our prayers and it includes our actions as well. And so human activity and divine activity are not mutually exclusive. They're not separate from each other. In other words, God's sovereign control of everything does not mean that we just sit back and do nothing. No, we still have human responsibility to make decisions and to vote and to express our opinions about laws and what's happening and so on. So we can do that, but ultimately God's in control of all of that. And I mean, that's another sermon to cover all of that for another time. One other place we went and looked at just briefly to finish up here was Te Papa. We popped in there. We just only had an hour. So we looked at the exhibition of Gallipoli. It's really, 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 really well done. If you're in Wellington, I'd encourage you to go and have a look at it. Gallipoli, just over 100 years, right? 100 years ago, New Zealand sent soldiers over to Gallipoli. I think 2,721 New Zealanders were killed in that battle. Close to 8,000 Australians were killed in it, and something like about 60,000 allies in total were killed in that battle in World War I. And then you look at that and you think about that. You know what? Life is crazy sometimes. Sometimes life can be hard to understand, and we ask questions sometimes like, why do horrible things happen? Why are there wars? Why do countries hate each other? Why do people go to war? Why do bad things happen to good people? Why do good people even die young? Why? Lots of questions. You know, Gallipoli was just mostly young people dying. The devastation was immense, and, you know, lots of people ask the question, well, where's God in all of this? Where's God in the middle of a war? Why does all of this stuff go on? Well, it's not just Gallipoli that we can ask those questions. We can ask those questions in the government debating chamber where life is hard, but we can even ask those questions a little bit closer to home. Maybe you're even asking the question this morning in your life. You know, why is my health failing? Why am I going through a financial crisis? Why am I having marriage problems? Why is there a crisis at my work? Why is there a relationship difficulty in my family? Why have I got a broken arm or a bruised leg? Or why did I have that fender bender? Or why did I get that parking ticket? Or why did my car get towed away? why did my house get built? Whatever. I mean, you got to ask those questions about your life and what's going on in your life. Why do tough things seem to happen? Well, I want to say to you this morning that God is sovereignly involved in the details of your life. The things that you consider to be good and the things that you might consider to be bad. Listen to this. If he didn't want them to happen in your life, they wouldn't happen. He would stop them before they happened. But he's using those times to challenge you and to change you, to mold you, to make you more like Christ, if you respond the right way to those challenges. And so that's the doctrine of the sovereignty of God. I find it personally very freeing and just remove stress from life when I know that God's in control of everything in my life, the good things and the bad things. Because whatever comes into my life, God has ordained, and he allows it to be in there, and he's using it for my good and for his glory. And so all I need to do is not necessarily ask the question, why is it happening? Ask the question or have the attitude, Lord, I don't necessarily know what's happening, but I trust you. I know you're good. I know you're perfect. I know you're wise. I know you're loving. I know you're all-powerful, and I can trust you. And so that's the attitude that God wants us to have in the midst of some difficult times. There's a lot of other things I was going to say, but I'll leave it for now. We're done with time. But, you know, we sang that song this morning, didn't we? I like that. Good choice, Jordan. Our God is a what? An awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. I mean, that's a great lyric to remind ourselves of. It's a great truth that Scripture tells us. And so maybe just as we even finish up this morning, we want to think about those words, think about those truths. We can trust God. He's in control. He's reigning. He's ruling. He's sovereign. He's powerful. He's almighty. And we can trust him with every little jot and tittle of our life, every little detail of our life. We can trust that God's in control and he knows what he's doing. He wants us to trust him. And not only that, he wants us to serve him. And not only that, he wants us to serve one another and to use the gifts that God's given us to use. We're going to finish with a song. I'll pray. You come on up. We'll finish singing. I think we're going to sing God of Wonders, which is probably a great song to finish on. Let's pray. Father, we just want to say thank you for who you are. We know you are an awesome God. We've stated it. We've sung it. We've reminded ourselves of it. And so, Lord, as we leave this building this morning, as we go out into this week in our various places, whether we've got little kiddies to look after, whether we've got school to go to, whether we've got work to go to, whether we're looking for work, Lord, whether we're running a business, whether we're working for an employer, whatever we're doing this week, Lord, I pray that you'd help us to go with these thoughts in our mind that you're an awesome God, that you're in control, and that we can trust you. Help us to do that. And Lord, again, I just want to pray for those that maybe are hurting this week, that have gone through some tough times. I pray for your special grace and blessing and comfort and peace in their hearts and in their lives. Lord, that they would be able to trust you no matter what they're facing. Help them do that for your glory, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yes, please stay.